This video will be a little bit different from most of mine. I'm revisiting a topic from my very first YouTube days, long before this channel was a thing. At the end, I'll link to a follow-up discussion on my second channel where I talk about why I'm making this again, but for now, here's what we're doing. In the Northern Hemisphere, it's winter right now. At least at the time of this video's upload. Winter means cold, and cold means sadness. But, thankfully, I have a friendly space heater to keep myself warm and my spirits high. These electric heaters are a useful, if perhaps dangerous, and expensive way to heat a space. But, there's been something that's annoyed me about them for years, and to show you, we need to go shopping.
Store number 1.
Alright, let's see what we got here. We have medium room, 1500 watts, for $31.99. Take a step over, and we have small room, 1500 watts, $12.79. That number's the same. Why is that the same? Here's a different one. Medium room, 1500. Okay, here's a different one. We got small...
Store number 2.
Well, store number 2 is almost entirely out of heaters.
Store number 2B.
This is what I get for doing this after the polar vortex. There we go.
Store number 3.
Okay, so here we have an infrared quartz radiant heater, which is being marketed as for medium-sized rooms. Shocker of shockers. 1500 watts. And also, this is a radiant heater, so really, the size of the room isn't as important as its application, but let's move on. So here we have a personal desktop heater. 1500 watts. This one is apparently some sort of genius. I don't really get that, but look at that, 1500 watts. Let's look at this guy here. It's a ceramic heater. 1500 watts. One of these 360 degree things. Oh, it's 1500 watts.
As you no doubt noticed, at every store we visited, many of the space heaters for sale were categorized based on the size of the room that they would be appropriate for. And yet, they were all rated 1500 watts. Now first, let me say that there are definitely reasons to choose some heaters over another. For instance, this infrared radiant heater will do a great job of keeping you warm even in a cold room, because the infrared radiation it generates will directly heat your skin, and thus body, from a distance. They're even useful outdoors because of their transmissive style of direct heating. But if you want to heat a space, as in heat a room and keep it warm, all of these heaters are doing the same thing. They're heating the air around them and are thus increasing the temperature in the room. With this goal in mind, literally any of these heaters will work. And they're going to work just as well as any of the others, with few exceptions. It all comes down to that 1500 watts. Let's take a step back and think about what heaters actually have to do. Heat is really just energy, and the temperature of a room is a way of expressing how much energy is currently concentrated in that room. Now, energy always likes to spread out, and if there's a temperature gradient between one space and another, the more highly concentrated energy in the warm place wants to exit the warm place and spread out into the cold place. Once it reaches equilibrium, energy transfer stops, and eventually this leads to the heat death of the universe. Now, to keep a room warm when the outside is cold, we have to keep releasing energy into it. And we need to add energy at least the same rate that it leaves through the walls and windows, which hopefully are well insulated to slow that process as much as possible. The amount of energy leaving the room is called the thermal load. Now, I'm going to use the BTU, that's British Thermal Unit, for much of this video. I'm sorry for picking that unit, please write your complaints below. The heater's basic job is to replace the energy that's leaving the room. So, if the room is losing 4,000 BTUs per hour through the walls, that's the thermal load, and thus we need a heater which can produce at least 4,000 BTUs in order to maintain the current indoor temperature. We'll need more than that if we want to increase the temperature, and if we can't produce 4000 BTUs, the room will gradually get colder until the temperature gradient is small enough that the energy leaving equals energy being added, and we hit equilibrium once more. You may be asking what this has to do with space heaters. Well, children, it turns out that watts and BTUs are both units of the same thing. That's energy.
Hold on, no. Watts are a unit of power, and a watt-hour is a unit of energy. BTUs makes this confusing because people often say BTUs per hour, which I've already said at least once, but anyway, it's a mess. Let's continue.
1 watt equals 3.41 BTUs. Now, all of these space heaters are labeled as using 1500 watts. That means they all produce 5120 BTUs. All of them. Some of them are even kind enough to tell you that. So then, I put forth to you, dear viewer, how is this heater more suited to a medium-sized room if it is producing the same exact amount of heat as this heater, which claims to only be suitable for a small room? Regardless of how much energy is leaving a given space, both of these are capable of adding the same amount of energy back. That's 5120 BTUs. Now, we can argue as much as we want about how these two heaters distribute the heat they create, but I do find it humorous that the one claiming to be better suited to a larger room doesn't have a fan to assist heat distribution. Instead, it relies solely on the convection currents that are created as the now hot, low-density air rises up through it and pulls cold, dense air from behind. This heater has a fan blowing air past its ceramic heating elements. Surely, it's moving more air. You can feel it. But honestly, it doesn't need to do much because of that little thing we call convection. No matter where heat is released into a room, it will eventually spread out. Using a fan just speeds that process along. And for those that may want to point out that the fan motor in this guy is part of that 1500 watts and therefore it must cause the unit as a whole to release less heat, I'll counter that in addition to the motor being a negligible part of the heater's energy consumption, all of that energy will eventually be released as heat anyway, either through friction with air molecules or through the wasted heat contained in the windings of the motor itself. The reason why I know without a doubt that these two heaters are both doing the same work is that they are both electric resistive heaters. This means they're taking the electrical energy from the wall outlet and releasing it as heat. This is 100% efficient. In fact, when we talk about efficiency of various household devices like light bulbs or laptops, we're really talking about how much waste heat they avoid releasing as they do their work. An incandescent bulb releases a ton of waste heat because it needs a lot of electrical energy to produce a given amount of light, the vast majority of which is simply wasted. An LED bulb releases much less heat because LEDs are a more efficient way of turning electricity into visible light, which means less electricity is consumed by the bulb to do the same amount of work. But if our goal is to create heat, in other words, if the work we want to accomplish is to take that electrical energy and spread it out into the room as heat, 100% of the energy being consumed will be directly released into the room. There is no such thing as a more efficient space heater. There are better and worse applications depending on the type, such as infrared radiant versus oil-filled convective, but simply put, energy is energy. If this medium heater can't release more energy into the room than its small room counterpart, then those labels are nonsense. And they are. We don't even need to rely on the labeling. If we use an energy monitoring device like this kilowatt, we can see exactly how much energy each of them is using. And shocker of shockers, it's the same amount within a small margin of error.
Well, some may argue that the margin of error isn't quite that small, but in any case, it's pretty humorous that the small heater is about 90 watts more powerful than the medium heater.
Many heaters have multiple settings which will switch between different heating elements, therefore giving you the option of a more tepid amount of heat output, and nearly all of them have a bimetallic thermostat, if not a digital one, allowing you to control the temperature within a reasonable degree. You might be asking why so many of them are rated 1500 watts. It turns out that this is the maximum amount of power a device that continuously operates is allowed to pull from a 15 amp circuit, according to the National Electric Code. A normal 15 amp household circuit is technically capable of 1800 watts, but if a device is expected to run for a long time, like a space heater, it's limited to using 80% of that capacity. This creates a margin for error and protects against fires caused by not quite up to snuff wiring, and it also helps prevent overloading in general. But a device that's only used intermittently, like a hairdryer, is allowed to use the full capacity. Since heating elements are phenomenally cheap and easy to make, pretty much all space heaters are going to bump right up against that 1500 watt limit. Now, not all of them do. I'm a big fan of these little personal heaters that only use a couple hundred watts. I keep this one on my desk, and it's a great little comfort boost on a cold day. But most general-purpose heaters will go ahead and push out as much heat as they're allowed to. Now, what was pointed out to me the last time I made this video was that heaters, such as this one, store heat in the oil and thus are able to release heat even when the heating elements aren't turned on. That's great, but it doesn't mean it's more efficient. It just means that the heat leaving the heater goes through a buffer. If the heater is running at a 50% duty cycle, it more or less is constantly releasing 2560 BTUs, when this heater would release 5120 for 5 minutes, and then 0 for the next 5 minutes. The end result is the same though, they both release 2560 BTUs over 10 minutes. This one may simply provide more consistent heat. If there's one thing I'd like you to take away from this video, it's that any space heater that claims to be more efficient than its competition is... well, it's lying. I'm particularly irked by these premium space heaters that claim to save you money on your energy bills because of some new technology. One in particular rhymes with Schmiedenglur. Look, the way they save you energy is by simply being a space heater. That's by turning down the temperature to your whole house and only heating the room that you're in. Compared to any other space heater, this is no more efficient and, frankly, a waste of money. What's worse is that electric heat is almost always the most expensive kind of heat. In fact, I made a video on why in cold climates we usually burn fuels like natural gas for heat rather than use the electric grid. Yes, the heater itself is 100% efficient, but electricity generation is not. At least not yet. And that's kind of the space heater paradox. You can save money by using just one and lowering the temperature of your central heating. But if you decide to buy a bunch of these supposedly miracle heaters for every room in your house and use them instead of your furnace, you're going to be spending a lot more on energy. But let me be clear that the only reason I know these are all the same is that we're talking about resistive heat. If we venture into the land of heat pumps or gas-fired furnaces, now there are efficiency comparisons to be made. Some heat pumps work better than others, and condensing furnaces can release more than 95% of the energy from their heating fuel into the space, compared to only 80% for a conventional furnace. But any old electric heater is going to be 100% efficient. Whatever energy gets pulled from the wall goes straight into the room. So the next time you need to buy a space heater, go ahead and buy a cheap one. Those expensive ones are... well, they're just not worth it. This $10 wire element heater will do just as great of a job heating a room as will a $200 Schmiedenglur. Now, don't get me wrong, this thing is ugly and noisy and has a primitive thermostat. That red mark is where I like to set it. So I'm not about to say that this is objectively as good as one of those fancy pants heaters, but I can say with confidence that it heats just as well, and the cost of that energy is exactly the same. I will add that if there's a room that always needs supplemental heat, like a certain bedroom in a certain house I grew up in, I prefer the oil-filled type because they're probably the safest. A fan-forced heater will quickly overheat if the fan fails, and then you've got to hope that the overheat protection cutout works. These passive ones are pretty much immune from that failure, and because the heat is spread out over such a large surface area, nothing really gets that hot. Plus, they're virtually silent, which is nice. But keep in mind that they take forever to get warm, so they're really not great for short use. These baseboard-style heaters are a nice compromise, but their surfaces do get much hotter, so my gut tells me it's a little more dangerous. And allow me to express my bewilderment regarding a companion product for a space heater that doesn't seem to exist. As I said, pretty much all space heaters have a thermostat built in, but let's be honest, they're usually not great. It does regulate the temperature, but it's more of a let it run until the room's as warm as you want it, then slowly turn the dial down until it shuts off. Not very precise or consistent. And for those digital heaters, having the thermostat located within the unit itself, like this, means that it will never get a very precise temperature reading of the room. I'm surprised that you can't just buy a universal remote thermostat. I can imagine something like a 10-foot-long heavy-duty extension cord with a thermostat in the middle of it, letting you put it on a table away from the heater itself and set an actual temperature. You could actually build one yourself fairly easily using a thermostat for baseboard heating, but it seems like a product that should just exist.
Okay, wait, it does exist. Look at that. An outlet thermostat. actually a really good idea.
Anyway, that's it for now. Dishonest marketing departments and misleading labels are some of the most annoying things we deal with on this planet, but thankfully, with a little knowledge on how the world works, we can see right through them. Stick around a little longer for a few more observations regarding my recent space heater adventures, and be sure to check out the Technology Connections 2 video about why I remade this video. As always, thank you to everyone who supports the channel on Patreon, especially the fine folks that are scrolling up your screen. With the support of people just like you, Technology Connections has gone from my hobby to this, and I'm very thankful for your support. If you would like to support the channel and get perks like early video access, occasional behind-the-scenes footage, as well as other Patreon-exclusive content, please check out my Patreon page. Thank you for your consideration, and I'll see you next time. Alright, so I was ready to buy a heater just like this one for this video, as Polonus was among my list of offending manufacturers who categorize based upon room size. But, at least for oil-filled heaters, they've dropped that. Now it simply says whole room heater. They're apparently not quite out of the woods yet, as this little thing is marked small room, even though, you guessed it, it's 1500 watts. But I will give them credit for this very handy and truthful guide to which type of space heater is appropriate for which application. Though there were apparently a few render bugs when it comes to the illustrations. Comfort Zone is still happily slapping room size suggestions on their products, but notably their oil-filled heaters, at least the ones for sale here, have gotten smaller and are only rated 1200 watts now. My guess is that this was a cost-cutting measure, and if you reduce its physical size and thus surface area, you'll need to lower its heat output too. Both Comfort Zone and Polonus used to rate this style as for a large room, but perhaps as a result of the 300 watt reduction, Comfort Zone has downgraded theirs to only a medium-sized room. Which is actually even more humorous because this medium room heater produces less heat than this small room heater. Go figure. I find this example particularly egregious because they're suggesting that a physically larger heater using the same ceramic heating element technology is better for a larger room. It's got two heating elements, surely it puts out more heat! No! This is just yet another design that you can pick from, and hopefully you pick the most profitable one.
Oh. These things. I wonder how many watts this uses. All 5127 prototypes, that's useful, I guess. So I'll have to look that one up online.